Good evening. Let me begin by introducing Elizabeth Kolbert, who's here at Williams as the class of 1946 visiting distinguished professor of environmental studies. Were I to try to list all of Betsy's accomplishments and honors, we wouldn't have any time left for anything else, so I'm going to mention just a few. Her book, Field Notes from a Catastrophe, Man, Nature, and Climate Change, was chosen as one of the 100 notable books of the year in 2006 by the New York Times Book Review. Her most recent book, The Sixth Extinction and Unnatural History, the book the college selected for Williams Reads this year, won the 2015 Pulitzer Prize in the general nonfiction category and is number one on the Guardian's list of the 100 best nonfiction books of all time. Top that. Betsy has won the National Academy of Sciences Communication Award in the newspaper and magazine category, the prestigious Heinz Award, which recognizes individuals that are addressing global environmental change, the Sierra Club's David R. Brower Award, and she recently was honored with the Walter Sullivan Award for Excellence in Science Journalism from the American Geophysical Union. So why all the awards and honors? There are talented writers who divert us or who tell us what we want to hear. And let's face it, that goes down easy. There are writers with the integrity not to tell us what we want to hear, but tell us what we need to know. And that's harder for us to swallow, and often we don't. We put down the book or we turn the page to another article. And then there are writers, all too few, like Betsy Kolbert. What all of Betsy's books and articles have in common is a combination of incisive analysis, crisp and compelling prose, and a focus on the particulars of people and places and nature that draws us into whatever world it is that she has chosen to reveal to us, telling us what we need to know in a way that keeps us reading despite the temptation to turn away. That's hard to do, and it is incredibly important work. Tonight, we're going to be talking about confronting climate change. And so let me lead off with the first question. And the first question is that your first book was about climate change, and your second about extinctions. And how do you see the relationship between the two?
OK, before I launch into that question, I want to thank I want to thank everybody who did the Williams Reads program, because there's nothing an author likes more than having people forced to read the book and to have copies distributed for free. So I really want to thank Williams and to thank everyone who read the book and everyone who led all the discussions, which I hope were edifying or fun in some way. So that's how I wanted to start. And I also wanted to start on a little deflationary note, because Ralph said that the book was chosen by The Guardian as the number one nonfiction book, and it was the first in this long list, but of course, my husband decided to look into that. You know, he was like, can't really be the number one. But, so he did look into it, and he realized that they were taking the subject matter in sort of chronological order. So since my book goes back half a billion years, it immediately got to be number one. So that's just a little bit by way of explanation. Okay. So now to the actual question, Ralph's actual question about climate change. My first book was about climate change, and we have this handy chart up here, so I'm not going to give you kind of the whole climate change spiel. You all know what this is, the Keeling curve up there. And when I wrote that book, that first book, which is just 10 years old this year, CO2 levels were down at about 380 parts per million. Now, this is a very, very recent reading. You see they're up above 400 parts per million. So in that time, as you can see, a lot has happened just in that short amount of time. And I'm just going to show a couple other slides of what's happened. This is just showing you the historical record of CO2. Those are from ice cores. You also see current CO2 levels up there in a sort of straight line going up. You see what's happening to global temperatures. And this is a very recent figure. This is just this year's temperatures, which you see are really almost literally off the charts. That's 2016, the first 6 months. This will almost certainly, 2016 is almost certainly going to be the warmest year on record. You see all the other warm years have also been very recent, but they're sort of bunched together. And then I'm just going to show you one other thing. This is a very new graphic that someone put together. It's just going to show you in a little animation what's happened to global temperatures over the last, since we have instrumental records, so since the 1880s, and it just takes 1 second to get going. So that just gives you a little bit of a sense of what's happening to the climate as we sit here. And I think that really, honestly, the reason that I wrote this most recent book in a way was, well, people hadn't paid any attention to the first book. So I was sort of trying to raise the stakes. And so that's one way that they're connected. Another way that they're connected is obviously climate change is a driver of extinction. It is not yet a big driver of extinction. I want to be honest. We can't really point to too many species that have, we can say definitively, have been driven to extinction by climate change. But there is actually just a recent story from a tiny little island called Bramble Cay, which is between New Guinea and Australia, and a little creature called the Bramble Cay melimus, I think I'm pronouncing it correctly, which is actually a kind of rat, I'm afraid.
Rats are people too.
Exactly. When recently went extinct because of rising sea levels, so the Cay is just inundated sometimes now. So we're going to see, you know, sort of more and more of that. But the other way that they're connected is, and I'm sorry this is such a long-winded answer, is that climate change sort of turned out to be, people kept saying after I wrote the book on climate change, you should really write about this. This is another way that we're changing the planet on this, you know, huge permanent geological basis. So that was ocean acidification and changing the surface of the Earth and moving species around the Earth. And it seemed like actually climate change, as big a story as it was, wasn't really actually as big as the story of how we are changing the planet. So that's sort of the connection between how the second book came to be.
What you just said about climate change and in the process mentioning ocean acidification raises an interesting question, and that is climate change, or more specifically, changes in global surface temperatures, gets a lot of attention. Ocean acidification, much less. But in your recent book, you really talk a great deal about the perils of ocean acidification. Why do you think it is that temperature gets the attention and ocean acidification doesn't?
Well, I was talking to a group of students this afternoon, and one of the young women who had been at Mystic raised exactly that question, you know, why don't we pay more attention to what's going on in the oceans? And I think everyone who studies the ocean asks that same question. And I don't have a great answer for it, except that we are obviously terrestrial creatures. And I think we don't have a very intuitive sense of what it means to change the chemistry of the oceans, how dramatic that is, how what life would be like if you only interacted with the outside world through the medium of water. But I think the reason that many scientists feel that ocean acidification is an even graver threat than temperature changes is it's actually very, very difficult to change the chemistry of the oceans. You have to, you know, really, really work hard at it, as we've been doing. Climate change has happened, as we all know, periodically in the past, ice ages to interglacials. But to change the chemistry of the ocean requires a really rapid release of CO2 of the sort that we're having now. It just doesn't happen very often. So people who are have looked back at the record of all of the last half billion years feel that there's quite possibly no, you know, precedent for the way that we're acidifying the oceans right now. That's just never happened this fast before, though we have seen ocean acidification in the past. So I don't know why we don't pay more attention.
I'm guessing that many people in the room have read your book, but maybe there are one or two who have not.
Really?
For shame. Would you just talk a bit about what happens when we have ocean acidification on the scale that we seem to be creating it?
Well, I'm so glad you asked. I actually brought for those of you who didn't read the book, this is a place I went to in the book. You don't actually see this picture, but I went to this location off of Ischia, the island of Ischia in the Bay of Naples, with a photographer for National Geographic. And what happens in this place is that there are actually bubbles of CO2 rising out of the bottom of the water. So it's a naturally acidified water. And the reason it's acidified, just to go one step back, is because when CO2 dissolves in water, you get an acid. You drink it when you had a Coke today, but it's a weak acid, but it's an acid. And so to give you just a sense, a visceral sense of what ocean acidification looks like, this is, we're in the Bay of Naples underwater, and you're seeing a pretty ordinary array of Mediterranean creatures. So we're away from these seeps, they're called, or vents, where the CO2 is bubbling out of the water near Mount Vesuvius. And I went out with this guy, and we swam up to these vents. You're seeing the CO2 vents there, and you see that a lot of the species, many of the species, it basically looks like a vacant lot, have dropped out of the water where it's acidified here. So if you remember your high school chemistry, or those Williams students here who are taking chemistry, here we're at a pH of 7.8, which is about about 150 times more acidified than the water is today, but that we could easily get to by 2100 throughout the oceans in all the world if we keep dumping CO2 in. So this is giving you sort of a view into the future, and scientists are studying it really carefully to see what the oceans of the future could unfortunately potentially look like if we keep on this trajectory.
Well, that raises the question about confronting climate change. What do you think of when you think about confronting climate change?
Well, I think there's a lot of different ways, and I think it was maybe you came up with that phrase, Ralph, and I think it was clever because it can be read many different ways. You could confront climate change in an intellectual sense, you know, the way you confront, you know, many thorny issues, the way you confront, you know, death. There's really nothing you can do about it, but we are called upon to confront it. Or you could confront it in a, you know, practical sense. What are we going to do about this? Confronting a problem, that's how we often use the term. And to me, I certainly hope that this year will be used actually for both of those purposes, both in an intellectual and in a practical sense. But I'm going to turn the question, you know, back on you, since you came up with it. What did you hope that we were going to get out of this?
No fair. Well, I have been struck by the difficulty of action. Not so much of necessarily political action, but of actually making the personal choices that, even to a modest degree, take into account my impact on the planet. You know, people have done analyses of how much carbon dioxide measured in tons the average human can put into the air every year between now and 2100, if we're to keep global warming to anything like 2 degrees centigrade, 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, and it comes out to 1 metric ton per human being per year. And to put that in some perspective, the average American puts in about 17 metric tons per human per year. The global average is about 5 metric tons per person per year. One round trip flight from the East Coast to the West Coast, economy class, no, it actually matters because business class takes up more room, is somewhere around 2.3 metric tons. So you take one flight round trip and you've used up more than twice what one might think of as the average fair share of a typical human's contribution to atmospheric CO2 in a year. And that's really scary because then you find yourself saying, well, what exactly am I really willing to do to change my contribution to the despoiling of the planet? And that's an ethical confrontation, it's intellectual confrontation. It's really, really hard. And part of what motivated me to come up with that title for this coming year is that I want the college as an institution and the college community as a body and the individuals in the college to really have to think about what it is that we feel is important. Because if there is no planet B, as they say, then how much do we actually value the things that we are doing that are putting the planet at risk? To what extent do we owe something to the future? There are people who quip, you know, what did the future ever do for me? There's some logic to that, but not a very compelling one, I think. Should I take actions if other people aren't? Or does my willingness to confront this in a practical sense have an impact on others? That certainly played a role in the climate negotiations in Paris in the fall. So these are really, really hard questions, and I chose the title because I want to see the community confront these very, very difficult problems. There are no easy solutions.
Well, I have a follow-up question, which is...
This is not fair.
Yeah. Which is, I mean, one of the reasons I think it is, I mean, an interesting from an economics point of view, because one of the reasons that, you know, we as Americans emit so much is because we're wealthy. You know, that's there's a very, very strong correlation, and the same could be said of Williams. Williams has a very large carbon footprint per capita student because it's a very wealthy institution without that many students, or with a relatively small number of students. So, you know, on the face of it, you might say, well, wealth is actually the problem. And how would an economist answer that?
Give me more wealth and I'll do an experiment. You know. It's true that, I'm not sure that I would say wealth is the problem. It's related to it. You know, the typical resident of many sub-Saharan African countries puts maybe 1/5 of 1 metric ton of CO2 in the air. And the average for a citizen of India is about 1.5 metric tons, just a, you know, not even 2/3 of one cross-country flight by someone in the United States. Our standard of living, at least at present, is heavily dependent on use of energy. And we have certainly in the past 100 years or so gotten most of our energy from fossil fuels. And so if we think of our standard of living as some measure of our wealth, and I want to come back to that question, then you can say, yeah, I mean, the problem is not just numbers of people, or maybe not It wouldn't even be numbers of people if everybody on the world was living with as low a level of fossil fuel-based energy usage as people in sub-Saharan Africa. So then there's, again, sort of confronting this question, you know, what are our choices? So we could try to maintain the same level of consumption and the energy use that supports it, but get that energy from sources other than fossil fuels, from renewable fuels. That would help to address the problem. It would take a while to make that transition. It's not infeasible, but it could take some time. Or we could alter the things that we choose to consume. Again, trying to maintain a comparable standard of living, but have that bundle of things that makes up our standard of living be things that are not as energy intensive. I mean, that's another possibility. Another one would be to say, accept a lower standard of living, which very few people will voluntarily sign up to do. But that, to me, raises a very fundamental question for economists and also people, to somewhat mutually exclusive groups, I've been told. And that is, what do we really mean by our standard of living? You know, there's some of you, I can see some gray hairs or even bald heads in the audience, and people are old enough to remember the comedian Jack Benny, very, very popular and successful comedian for much of the 20th century. And one of his shticks was that he was incredibly cheap, obsessed with hanging on to his money. And in one of his great bits, a robber comes up to him and sticks a gun in his face and says, "Your money or your life?" And there's this long pause. And the robber says, "I mean it, you know, your money or your life?" And he says, "I'm still thinking, you know." So our standard of living really isn't just the sum of the income that we earn or the things that we buy, but it's heavily dependent upon the environment in which we live, both whether that environment is congenial for humans and whether that environment is congenial for all the things other than humans that are living that give us pleasure in our environment. And I think, you know, if economics can be faulted certainly for much of the 20th century, and to some extent still now, it's that it focused on measuring gross domestic product, measuring what we think of as well-being in dollars, and as opposed to a broader definition of our standard of living. And so to come back to that third way of reducing our damage to the environment, that is reducing our standard of living, I think it's kind of a false choice. If we don't change the amount of fossil fuel energy that we as humans consume in pursuit of a higher standard of living, we will in fact end up with a lower standard of living. So I don't know if that answered your question, but.
No, go ahead. Were you going to say something?
No, I was going to get some. No chance, you're on. You know.
Well, I think one of the things that we have discussed in various, you know, conversations about this is what is an individual's, you know, I don't know how this fits with the economics or this is more of an ethical question, but you know, what is the efficacy or the utility or the morality of, you know, when you lay out what one cross-country flight, which is, as you say, just, you know, the more than the emissions that if you were following a path of everyone should, that emissions should be distributed equitably for the next, you know, century, let's say, then we've all blown it by flying across the country once. And that's a choice in most cases, you know, we're kind of compelled to do that. So, you know, should we be focusing on asking individuals, you know, to cut back, or you know, is that basically a hopeless cause, or politically even misguided? Should we be focusing all of our energy on political change? And then when you say should we be focusing all our energy on political change, then you run up against current American politics, which are not very encouraging.
Thanks. Well, I think group action is essential. I also think, though, that it's very hard to make a compelling case for collective action if, as individuals, we're all slackers. And so I think that the extent that we can, we do have to confront these questions at an individual level and ask, what do we want to give to the future, and what can we as individuals do? What sacrifices are we willing to make? Should we be one-issue voters? It's not out of the question. If you think of the things that will have potentially the greatest impact on the greatest number of beings on the planet, particularly those who are most vulnerable to climate change, maybe the answer is that should be your single issue. But again, I think we have to avoid the kind of hypocrisy that says, I'm really for this, but I want everybody else to be the ones to make the sacrifice. I mean, certainly people in the poorest countries of the world, I think, feel really put upon when the countries in the global north say to them, and we all have to reduce our CO2 emissions. I mean, here are people who are putting, who have historically put, for all intents and purposes, no CO2 into the atmosphere. They've contributed nothing to the rising CO2 levels that you see on the Keeling curve. They're putting less than what would be a sustainable per human share of CO2 into the atmosphere. And we're saying to them, oh, and you have to, do your bit to cut back. And I can see why people would say, well, not really. On the other hand, it's also true that if we're actually going to have some sort of meaningful change in the trajectory of our fossil fuel use, it is going to be hard to get the countries in the global north to take a lot of action if they feel that by doing so, all that will happen is that countries in the global south will take over the production activities that are carbon intensive. So it's really, I think, a situation in which, to different degrees, almost everybody has to, in some way, play some role for things to work out well. Now, I'm not saying that I think things will necessarily work out well. I'm far too pessimistic a person for that. But I have a feeling that's kind of necessary. But you know more of the players than I do. So what's your sense?
No, I think that's true. And I think everyone goes, we sort of keep going around and around. That's obviously the problem. That's why those numbers keep going up. So I don't disagree with you, but I do think that, I think that the time for sort of, voluntary, we're gonna all chip in. I mean, I don't think that's the answer. I think we need pretty significant, very significant, political and economic, I should add, a change. And I'm not sure where that's going to come from. We will see in the presidential election what happens. And Obama has put in some regulations that are significant, but not as significant as we need by any stretch, and they are now in front of the Supreme Court, actually. They're stayed, and so we're going to get a new Supreme Court, and we're going to see what happens to them. So there's a lot of sort of just political uncertainty right now, but I think that we don't see, unfortunately, in this campaign, even as dismal as it is, we don't see a real
we don't see single issue voters. Maybe it would be foolish in this particular campaign to be a single issue voter. But it certainly, I think it has to rise to the very top of the list of voting issues. Unfortunately, if you look at polls, it's nowhere near there, you know, right now. Yeah.
It is worth mentioning that the consensus among a pretty significant majority of people who study this in a careful way is that it is in fact possible to implement a change to a renewable fuel economy, even in an energy squandering country like the United States, and that it would take some time, 30, 35 years, something like that, maybe a bit more. It would cost some trillions of dollars, probably somewhere the estimates range from, you know, 1 or 2 trillion up to 8 or 9 or 10 trillion dollars, which sounds like a huge amount of money, but actually not, first of all, when you spread it over 35 or 40 years, and when you realize what's at stake. It may actually turn out to be a bargain. I mean, people have been doing some calculations of the value of real estate, just real estate, in coastal areas in the United States that will be assets underwater, as it were, if we have the kind of sea level rise that we know is going to accompany rising temperatures. And so you're already talking about trillions and trillions of dollars, and that's just in the United States. If you think of the impact on vulnerable communities all around the world, and then all of the political and economic and social dislocation that will arise from that, and the political unrest, it may be the case that spending $175 billion a year, which is, you know, like a half of what we're spending on Medicare or something like that per year, is a bargain, and something that we shouldn't be at all frightened about.
Do you want to, should we involve anyone else who wants?
Yeah, I see a restive crowd here, so why don't we throw it open to questions, because we'd actually like to hear what some of you have to say. So if you have a question, raise your hand, we'll call on you. I'll probably want to repeat the question. Please don't pontificate. I will cut you off if you do. Carrie Green has told me to do that. But if you have a question, ask it. I will repeat it for the, I guess the, this is being videotaped. And then Betsy will answer it.
More about the sixth extinction.
The sixth extinction. Well, you really need to read my book. No. The sixth extinction, you got to be more specific. It's a pretty broad topic. You'd like to know what it is? Or
all those animals we
saw. Oh, all those, okay, I'll tell you about those animals. Those animals are all endangered, some of them very highly endangered. They were taken by a photographer named Joel Sartor, who is has this big project, and you can find his book actually at Water Street called Rare. He's a wonderful photographer. All those animals are actually animals in captivity. It's very hard to photograph very rare animals out of captivity because it's hard to find them. But that's his project. So those are all his photos, which he very kindly let me use. And yes, they're all very rare. In fact, the frog, there's one frog who sort of began the loop. It was a loop. He is literally the only one left in the planet. He is in the botanical garden at Atlanta. And I just called recently to find out if he was still alive. His nickname is Tuffy, because he's very old now. He's at least 11 years old now. And he is, in fact, still alive, but he is the only one that we know of left.
Yes, sir.
I recently heard how in the Netherlands, they've decided to give land back to the sea because of increased precipitation is going to bring more water down the rivers. And I'm wondering if each of you could talk a little bit about how, you know, a national psyche plays into something like that. culture in terms of collective action?
Well, I will take that first because I actually wrote about that program. It's called Room for the Rivers, and it's not giving land back to the sea. I just want to say it's giving land back to the rivers. You know, it's not letting in salt water, which is really problematic for the Netherlands. It's letting the rivers, which it's a river delta, so it's when there's heavy rains, as you say, and they're getting all that water from Germany. They just let it flood what was farmland, and they bought people out. It was not that contentious, but it was somewhat contentious. But if you go to the Netherlands, which you know, just as everyone knows, are the world experts on water control, and are now basically have made, you know, have many firms that go all the way around the world, all around the world, consulting because this is the issue of the future. They take it super, super seriously, and everyone takes it super, super seriously, and is very, very well organized, and has a, and they have a national plan that they carry out. You know, and one of the things that's I'm going to say downright scary is, you know, I was in Miami last fall, and I watched the water, you know, bubble up out of the storm sewers in a very high tide. And you talk to them about, okay, what's the plan for Florida? You have a governor of Florida who won't let you talk about climate change. Okay, so not only do they not have a plan, they're just in this kind of weird, you know, just state of, you know, being like Oz or something. It's very, I mean, if you look at it from that perspective of, you know, how our politics are really crippling our ability to deal with, you know, reality, it's pretty frightening. So in the Netherlands, I give them credit, they deal with, you know, reality. And they are looking at these projections, and they're very, very frightening. They're existentially frightening for the Netherlands, and they're actually existentially frightening for Florida, too.
I just want to thank you guys so much for holding this conversation tonight. I'm Ruby Project as a on campus, and we're working to pull the college's investments in fossil fuels. And my question is sort of twofold. You were talking earlier about the importance of not only, you know, individual actions, but also the need for like broader political change. And so my question is, what do you think the role is of like massive, especially student movements on a national level, like the divestment campaign, in creating those like sort of broader changes in our society? And then also, do you think it's possible for an institution like Williams to really confront climate change while still being invested in fossil fuel companies?
I'm going to make myself very unpopular with a fair number of people here. But the question is, well, several parts to it. One is, how do we feel about the divestment movement? Can the college actually take what it thinks of as meaningful action on climate change if it doesn't divest? And I think the third might have been just those two. Okay, so here's my problem with divestment in fossil fuel companies, and I think you're thinking of large fossil fuel companies of the sort that we see in the Fortune 500 and elsewhere. Those companies do not go to the capital markets floating equity stocks in order to get money to do what they do. Those ownership shares have been issued long in the past, and those companies are generating tens of billions of dollars a year in profits. If every shareholder in the world took his or her shares of those companies and said, I don't want another dividend, I'm going to burn them, the fossil fuel companies would be delighted. It would have zero impact on what they do. They don't need your money. So the argument then for divestment has to be an argument that by institutions like Williams and similar ones divesting, we help to create, contribute to creating, because we are spit in the ocean compared to the total assets out there, we contribute to a moral climate in which it is no longer acceptable to produce fossil fuels. I find that a hard argument to buy when we're all still consuming fossil fuels. It's not to me a very compelling moral statement. And I have another, more than one qualm with it as well, and that is, take a place like Williams. We have an endowment, $2 and a fraction billion. We generate about $100 billion a year or so that we actually take from our endowment earnings and endowment in order to fund activities that are the educational mission that we pursue. If we were to divest ourselves quickly of our fossil fuel holdings, and we don't have any direct ones, all of our money is in commingled funds, and many schools that have said they've divested, like Stanford, for example, have just basically done what we have done. We don't have any individual holdings in fossil fuel stocks. They're all commingled funds. But if we were to do that, there are some estimates that it could reduce our annual rate of return on our endowment by, let's say, 0.5%, which, half a percentage point, which doesn't at first sound like a lot, but that's $10 million a year. And I can think of $10 million a year worth of expenditures that I would cut out of the Williams budget. And many people probably could do the same, but they wouldn't be the same $10 million. And furthermore, to the extent that we don't actually cut our current expenditure to make up for the reduction in our revenues, but we eat down the endowment, then what we're doing essentially is punishing the students who will come in the future. Right? So if you were to ask me what would be a more meaningful action, it would be the students at Williams College saying, we want to fly less, travel less, have fewer athletic teams that are traveling, colder rooms, more hours of the day of classes, so we needed fewer buildings. I don't actually think that Williams College as an institution is going to have as big an impact on the way in which things play out by itself somehow divesting from fossil fuels, or even saying to the commingled funds with which we place our money that we don't want to have our money in those kinds of investments, than we would by actually, as an institution, taking real actions to reduce our CO2 footprint. That's me.
Okay, I would certainly agree with Ralph that Williams students would make a very, very powerful statement by, you know, looking very carefully at the campus, and I really hope that this year that will be part of the conversation, obviously. But I do want to take a little bit of an issue, or something of an issue, with Ralph's assessment, and I think that you know, I spent a lot of time last year with Christiana Figueres, who is the head of the UNFCCC, Framework Convention on Climate Change, and she spent a lot of her time going around before Paris talking to big investors, huge investors, company holding companies with many, many, many hundreds of millions of dollars invested, and saying, would you commit, please, to reducing the carbon footprint of your investment portfolio, right? So while that is not divestment per se, it seems to me that that is a conversation that Williams is absolutely obligated to have. If you believe, first of all, if you believe we're ever going to do anything about climate change, it's obviously in your financial best interest. You cannot continue, you know, to be invested in these companies that should, whose value should eventually, you know, go down to zero. And second of all, it seems to me that you do have to be part of that conversation. And you do have to be saying, okay, we do want to reduce the carbon footprint of our portfolio, because that is a big chunk of change. It's not, as you say, it's not going to move the world market. But everyone has to be part of that conversation. And even if you don't say we're going to be dumping, you know, our fossil fuel stocks, of which, you know, we may or may not have any direct holdings, I think you do have the obligation as part of this global effort to move a lot of capital into renewable energy, that Williams, especially in a year of confronting climate change, does have to have that conversation with its portfolio managers, that we want to see the carbon footprint of our investments change. We want to know what it is. I'm not sure that we do know what it is, and we want it to be, we want it to be ratcheted down over the next 10, 20 years.
I definitely agree that we should be doing more as a, as an institution with our wealth to promote alternative energy. And I think if you think about what would be the best way to bring about change, what you'd like to see would be investments in alternative energy that cause the existing system of energy use and production to unravel. And one way to think about that would be, you know, imagine that you could promote the use of solar energy, PV energy, and fewer people are purchasing fossil fuel-based electricity from the grid. And as people are buying fewer of those kilowatt hours generated by fossil fuels, the utilities, which are guaranteed by our regulatory system, a fair rate of return, would be entitled to higher and higher rates that they could charge for electricity. But as that happens, it makes it more attractive for people to put in PV cells to purchase less of that. And the system can unravel in exactly the same way that if you had a club with 100 members and one person pulls out, then it's more expensive for the remaining 99, and then one of them drops out and it becomes more expensive for the remaining 98, and so on. And so I would favor very much institutions like Williams and other institutions with financial resources, and you as individuals, making the kinds of choices with respect to your use of energy or investment in energy sources that would help the current system to unravel, basically. Replace it with something that is going to work better. Move that along. Another student? Do we have a student? Yep.
My question is about paradigm shifts, and Mrs. Kolbert, you talked about how we sort of wrapped our heads around the concept of extinctions in the 19th century, and we haven't, globally, we haven't really wrapped our head around human-caused climate change yet. The paradigm shift is not complete yet. You also mentioned group action and how it is necessary, and I was wondering if you think that we have to first complete the paradigm shift of understanding human-caused climate change in order to effectively confront the issue and act against it.
You might want to repeat the question for
us. So the question is, do we need a sort of a global, you know, paradigm shift to, confront, acknowledge that humans are capable of changing the climate, are in fact changing the climate, before we can effectively take global action? It's a really interesting question. I mean, I think that there is a lot of, there has been, I don't know if you could quite call it a paradigm, but there is this notion, you know, the world is really big, the oceans are really big, even humans can't really fundamentally alter them. And that is just evidently not true. We're proving that every single day. And there are 7.4 billion of us on the planet, and you can watch, you know, the global population, if you just go online to a global population clock, you know, you can watch it increase by, you know, I don't know how many millions per day. So we are very much capable of changing the climate, and how, whether we can do something about that without everyone being convinced. I mean, people, you know, often ask sort of me, you know, don't we need to bring all these, you know, don't we need political change as opposed to, you know, just sort of fiat of the president before we can confront these changes? And then the question, and on some level, the answer is obviously yes, you know. And on some level, the answer is, well, we don't really have time for that, you know. So we're in a situation where you know, yes, obviously we would benefit mightily from everyone, you know, being on the same page in terms of acknowledging what's going on or recognizing what's going on and being worried about what's going on. But if we are going to, if that's the point that we have to reach before we can take effective action, and perhaps you're right, implicit in that, that it is, then I think we're in even worse trouble than we seem to be right now, because I don't know when that moment's going to arrive. And we can't really, I mean, we've never really expected everyone to be on board. We don't really expect everyone to be on board for, you know, quantum physics, or, you know, we just sort of, you know, move ahead often when there's a scientific consensus. And I think that we have to try to do that, even in this case, though it's very, 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 very difficult. I agree.
What's really kind of disturbing is that, you know, Betsy showed the slides that show what's happening to CO2 levels in the atmosphere, what's happening to global temperatures. What does it take to convince people that this is caused by humans? And yet, the proportion of people in the United States, at least, that believe that humans are in fact causing global warming has actually decreased in the past 20 odd years because it's become politicized. You know, it's really terrifying. You really have to wonder at what point will people suddenly say, oh gee, I guess they were right. And then you have to wonder at that point, will the response be, it's so bad already, let's just party, you know, we can't do anything about it anyway, or let's those of us with money move to higher and colder places and something like that. I mean, it is kind of astonishing that at this point there are people who still deny that there is anthropogenic climate change. And at one level, for some kinds of people, I can understand it. In a way, if you define yourself as someone who believes that government is bad, that collective action is bad, if you are a dyed-in-the-wool libertarian, then global climate change caused by the actions of humans as individuals really presents you with a threat that I think you can only respond to by cognitive dissonance and denial. You know, if it's going to take collective action and the coercive power of governments to do things like impose taxes or things like that that would make us change our behavior, but you absolutely believe that the world is best if there is no coercive action of any kind of government, no collective power, then what do you do except maybe say, it's not really humans after all? I think you're really in a bind in that situation, and there are no small number of people in that situation. It's really tough. Another question from a student. Student, yes.
Hi, thank you for your time, obviously. Firstly, I'm kind of optimistic about the future, but I think that one of the greatest risks that we're facing isn't so much what we're doing, but in part it's also some of the actions, kind of the backup options as well, things like geoengineering and things that are, you know, highly invested. Is there a path that we could take to sort of prevent that from really being an option, even though it's kind of being pushed forward by a lot of people, a lot of money?
Absolutely, there are options. There's a very interesting... Oh, I'm sorry, the question was, do we have any alternative to geoengineering? Are there paths we can take? And the answer is, you know, absolutely. If you look at, just the United States, and we are something of a laggard relative to a lot of other industrialized countries in terms of our use of renewable power from photovoltaics and from wind. Only 1% of all electricity in the United States is generated from photovoltaic power. But the cost of photovoltaic power has been plummeting. Only about 5% of our power comes from wind in the United States. But the cost of wind power has been plummeting. It is both technologically and financially feasible for us to make a, from what is an historic perspective, a pretty rapid transition to a renewable fuel base for our energy needs. You know, to do something by 2050, it's just 35 years. That's not that long, right? That's doable, and to be honest, is probably, from the perspective of avoiding the potential for really bad outcomes, a far better strategy to pursue than to try to do some kind of geoengineering, which either might not work or might have, you know, terribly negative consequences. If you think about wind power, you know, if a windmill has a mechanical failure, it's not nice, but it's not as if it's going to damage the world in a noticeable way. And contrary to what some people, and I forget if it was Alabama or Georgia, said, photovoltaic cells don't suck up all the sun, leaving none for the plants in the area. So, you know, these are relatively benign technologies, and it will take money. But again, once you have spent the money to put these methods of producing energy in place, then you're no longer having to spend the money every single year to extract and refine and transport fossil fuels. And that's actually those figures of somewhere in the vicinity of you know, $2 to $10 or so trillion dollars for the United States. Anyway, those figures take account of the fact that you don't have to buy fossil fuels then forever to get your energy. And remember that fossil fuel burning energy systems require repair and maintenance and replacement. And so instead of replacing them with the same, you replace them with something that is different. That too will require maintenance, but you're no longer then contributing to the destruction of the planet. And you know, suppose that it costs more. That even when we take everything into account, we'd be spending a greater part of our income on energy if we had to get it from truly renewable sources. Again, this comes back to what I was saying before about, you know, what is it that really makes us happy, gives us well-being. And one of those things is the very congenial planet on which we live. And if we destroy it, however, you know, many iPads we get to consume, life is not going to be great. You know? Another student question? We have another student?
Over there, Robbie.
Hi. Thanks for coming. You talk a lot in your book about animals that are very endangered and how we've attempted to solve the problem by taking the last one or two examples of a species and raising them in captivity. I feel like your prose suggests that's a little sad. Do you think that's the only viable way right now of solving that problem, or do you have any personal suggestions on what we could do to get to a place where that's not the only solution we have?
So the question is that in the book I discuss several examples where we're down to very, very few representatives of a given species, and we take them into captivity and we try to breed them. And this student is suggesting that that's a little sad. And might there be a better way? And I certainly think it's very sad. And it is, you know, the obvious thing to do is to prevent these species from getting down to their last 100 members, who are one member. When you don't choose one member, you're really, that's the end. Unless you're hermaphroditic, I guess.
Then you're down to social media.
But, you know, often, I mean, it's kind of an interesting characteristic of ours that we have a hard time doing that. And E.O. Wilson has a book out now called Half Earth about putting, you know, we need to put basically half of the planet aside, you know, for the rest of the species, which really, you know, when you think about it, is not really asking very much, since, you know, maybe there's 10 million species on the Earth and, you know, we're one. So you can do the math on that. But You know, unfortunately, more and more, you know, instances were getting down, you know, to very, very, very few. And at that point, everything kicks into gear. And that's actually also here in the U.S. sort of the way the Endangered Species Act is written. You know, you have a population crash, and at that point, you know, then you have to really work to bring the species back. But it's very hard as the species declining to say, okay, you can't do this, you can't mine, you can't timber, you can't do all these other things, because it's going to cause the species to go into decline. So that kind of proactive approach, which obviously is preferable to the reactive approach, is just very difficult, because, you know, there's so many, you know, people want to cut down those trees, or it's a lot of it's on private property. I mean, there's a million conflicting uses for this, let's say it's a habitat problem, which sometimes it's not. So I don't have a great answer, but obviously it's pretty damn sad when you're down to the last 100 individuals of any species, and your odds are not good at that point. You know, that they'll ever, you might keep them alive, but they're never functionally going to be part of that ecosystem again. It's very rare, although it has happened. I mean, there are some success stories even at that level. So, you know, I do appreciate the people who say never give up, but it certainly is something that we can't keep doing as more and more species, you know, head toward the brink. We definitely need a more holistic, you know, approach if we're going to prevent that.
And although it's not exactly on point, it just kind of reminds me in some ways of the issue about, let's say, aesthetic objections to wind turbines. People say, oh, you know, you've got these on all the ridges and the hillsides, or you're going to have them out in the ocean, and I'll see them from my Nantucket home. And whenever I hear those, I can't help thinking that it's not the case that we can have the power that we're getting from fossil fuels and keep the environment that we have. We can go to renewables and have some of our viewshed disturbed in some ways, and maybe we'll kill some birds with the turbine blades, try to avoid it if we can, but maybe some will go. But if we just keep doing what we're doing, then we will lose what we have. I mean, even in this area, it's absolutely shocking to think that according to NOAA, the average wintertime temperature in western Massachusetts today in 2016 is 3 1/3 degrees higher than it was in 1970. That's not a very long period of time. It's absolutely astonishing. It's not as elevated as much in the summer as it is in the winter. It's only about 2 degrees warmer in the winter. But think of that. 40 years, 3.3 degrees Fahrenheit, and the rate of change of global warming is accelerating. So, you know, we've had globally, you know, let's say a degree centigrade in since 1850, and almost a third of that has occurred in just the last 20 years, which means that the rate of increase is just terrifying. And, you know, we think about Williamstown and the Purple Hills and the sugar maples in the fall, and we're not going to have that when our climate is that of Georgia. And that's not that many decades away if we keep doing what we're doing. They're very stark choices that we face. Yes.
I'd like to ask you a question about politics, because you raised that one of the problems that we're facing is that we need a political change. I'd like you to think more about that and what, you know, the scientists are doing to thrasher or whatever?
Well, the question is that I alluded to the fact that we needed a political change, and that I should say more about what, how that's going to happen. I wish I knew. And what scientists are doing, which is an interesting story. I mean, there are a lot of fights going on right now about, you know, there's actually a. I just got an email from a group that defends climate scientists, you know, legally, and there's actually a lot of really awful stuff going on about people's, you know, all their emails being, if you get any government money, which any scientist does, right, these days, a grant, you know, all your emails, every single email being subpoenaed by some group or FOIA'd, and you have groups like, you know, House committees subpoenaing climate scientists to, you know, try to deride, you know, their work. So political change, you know, the very opposite of political change. You know, our politics are sort of, it seemed unimaginable that they could get worse, but they kind of have. So there's a lot of really, I mean, it hasn't quite raised to the level of making headlines, but it's really, really bad, and it's very painful, obviously, if you are the scientist involved. So there's a real attempt to just basically, you know, shut people up. I mean, I don't know how, as you say, it's very hard to cut off, you know, the information, which is just so much in your face and out there these days. But, you know, how are we going to get political change? You know, that, your guess is as good as mine, and that's what everybody, you know, that I'm kind of assuming is sort of the implicit point of the Williams-Reeds program, and it's like, yeah, let's get on with it, let's do it. It's just the way you get any kind of political change, you know, and it's movements, and it's protests, and it's voting, and it's hard work, and it's organizing, and I don't know how it's gonna happen, because, you know, as I said before, it needs to happen really pretty soon.
Thank very much both Ralph and Betsy for this conversation.